NRL Fantasy round 26, buy, hold, sell. A little bit different this week. We're going to focus on captain options, and we've got Biz dialing in from overseas, mate. Where are you right now?
Yeah, I'm in front of some castle in Scotland. I made a last second spontaneous decision to hire a car, drive up here from London. I was visiting a friend over the weekend. So I don't know how good the video recording quality will be. I think Longy will cut me off once the sound gets too bad. But hey, look, I'm keen to wrap up the NRL season, start my NFL drafts. But yeah, captaincy options for round. I've lost count what we're up to now.
Around 26, mate. Look, it's clear for the moment. Sounds pretty good. So we'll roll into it pretty quick. Look, Isaiah Yeo is obviously that first captain. And I've got these ranked by price, but 85 points last week, pumped out a bunch of work, had the try assist as well. Up against South Sydney this week, no Cam Murray for them as well. You think this is a good option?
Yeah, I had Yeo last week. It wasn't the most inspiring captaincy option, but it worked out pretty well. I mean, we had quite a few big scores last week. He's a safe guy. I think with Cleary gone, they'll rely on him. Obviously, losing a couple of games towards the back end of the year means that, you know, they'll probably keep him out there. And I think next week's going to be the rest for him. So Panthers have named the full-strength team, and I think he's going to be on the field. He pretty much scores in every category and more attacking stats with Cleary gone. So he's probably not the most exciting option, but, you know, he'll give you 60, at least 55, and he's shown he can score this 80-plus as well. So I'll probably keep it on him, but it's not the most exciting thing to do.
I will say, too, Penrith are fighting for a home final, so they've got to win some games to lock that in. And, you know, if they're in that contention in round 27, they probably don't rest him, is my view, but could be good. Could be good news.
That's actually a good point. Maybe they don't rest him next week, but I suspect if they get out to a lead, they'll cut him off early. And you've been saying that Yeo's the type of guy that they don't always or don't often give a full rest to, but more of a shortened rest towards the back end of the game.
Yeah, in which case he still pumps out 50, so we can live with it. I'm going to talk about Nico Hines here as well. So he's on the extended bench this week. It's a pretty late game. But I'll tell you what, if I was not as dumb as I am and had a trade left in the bank, I would be looking at Nico Hines at 807K and just thinking, you know what? Up against the Warriors this week, mate, there are worse guys to buy and captain as a super pod, and you'd be one of the only people in the comp who has him. I'm into this.
Yeah, I mean, I think when you've got nothing to lose in round 26, like, Hail Mary, why not? I mean, I don't love it myself. Like, he might come onto the bench. Trindle and Atkinson are playing pretty well. He might be eased into it. He might not get the dominant playmaking. But if you're going to have a pod, it's probably Hines, right? You'll have like less than 1% ownership. It'll be a fun own. But I think if you're in with a serious shot, you're in the kind of top, you know, 200 to 500 and you're trying to hustle, I probably wouldn't risk it on Hines. But if you're like me dropping off into 3,000-ish, why not? What have you got to lose, right?
What I'd look at there too is there's some coaches who are in head-to-head grand finals this week and they've used all their trades to get there. So they're in a spot where they're now really struggling, and they've now got, say, squads of 14, 15 players. So with them, they're looking at Nico Hines and thinking, if I'm going to be down a couple of players anyway, this is the kind of guy who could, against the Warriors, really pop off. So, yeah, look, it's a risky option, but it's one that I like if you're looking for that long shot. I'm going to talk through a few here. I've seen the wind has picked up there for you, Biz, so I'll carry the team for a little bit.
Put my microphone on mute every time the gust comes through.
Genius, mate. Well, look, Damien Cook's next one here, 43 points. He's up there in terms of price. I don't consider him a captain option for this week. Penrith is a good matchup in terms of being a tough opposition. And I've been going on and on and on about Mama Zella stealing minutes. It finally happened last week. Not heaps minutes. He still played about 65, but you need that full 80 minutes for Cook. So I'd be steering clear of this one. Keep him if you have him, but don't make him your captain. Now, I'll throw to you, Biz, Barnett and Fenua Blake, both up against Cronulla. Do either of these guys tickle your fantasy as a captain option?
I feel like Barnett has a very high upside. We've seen him score 100-plus before, but excuse the gust that's coming through. Fenua Blake's just been in a real, real hot run of form recently. He keeps pumping up 60-plus scores. Last game for the Warriors this week, with a bye next week, I think he'll want to sign off his stint there with a high note. I think he's a good option for this week. I wouldn't be surprised if he scores a try to say goodbye up against his new team. I reckon he can do another 75 this week.
Yeah, Fenua Blake, beastman option. Got to say, too, the dedication from you, bro. Dialing in to record this podcast in the middle of a hurricane in northern Scotland. You know how it's cold, guys. If you haven't been to Scotland, by the way, it is so cold. Like, absurdly.
It's meant to be summer, I think. I can't tell from the weather.
You know what? Actually, it is. When I was there, it was December, so it was...
That's truly inspirational. But, hey, if only the paramedics could show this level of dedication.
Oh, man, I'm wearing my jersey. You know, I'm just trying to get ready for next year, trying to get myself excited for the Spoon Bowl. I'm going to be going to that game, by the way. We've got the Tigers to avoid the Spoon. So, hey, Paris still have something to play for. Tommy Turbo, we'll give this a shout too. And we talked about Turbo. Look, both of us were saying the same thing about him. If he scores a couple of tries a week and plays like a Dally M Player of the Year, he's a fantastic fantasy option. It's just a big bet to make. Well, the bet's paid off. He's been pumping out huge scores. 91 was the top scorer of the week last week. Do you fancy him against the Dogs this week, or do you think the Dogs are too much of a lockdown side? Like, what's your feel on this one?
I think Dogs are a great side in terms of they're playing real gritty this year. But I think back to we're saying, if you know, the Tommy Turbo analysis, that he's going to have to score like three tries a game or five assists a game to get to, you know, 80, 90 points. And this was proof, like a hat trick in 90 points. Like, it's just not – that year he averaged about 90 is just ridiculous, right? It doesn't – like, he's playing so well right now. Well, he could – I mean, it's hard to say. Like, we spoke about the Tigers matchup and, you know, they lost their game, but it was a shootout. This one I think will be more of a grind at Canterbury. I don't think they've dropped a game this year at home. So I wouldn't be captaining Tommy Turbo. But if you have him and you've been riding this great run of form, congrats. He must be doing wonders for your rankings.
Mate, you'd be absolutely flying. I agree with you, though. I think around that 40-point mark this week is what I've gotten written down for. It's probably a bit unders in terms of projections, but that's where I've got him sitting. I'll mention, too, so Payne Haas, he's named on the extended bench. Now, tell me if you disagree, Biz, but for me, this one is... not that inspiring of a pickup. Even if he gets brought into the starting side, brought onto the bench, he'll probably only play 40 to 50 minutes. They've got very capable guys. They've got Jensen and Wilson, who are doing a great job. They've got the Dolphins this week, who have been leaking some points as well, so they could run out a bit of a lead potentially. Saying that, they nearly lost to Parramatta, so maybe the Broncos do need Haas out there. Like, there's a few things to think about here, but for me, Haas is probably not a guy you're going to go after, saying that he is a super pod.
Yeah, I think now I've got dogs barking too, so this is going well.
That's fine. I was going to win.
Yeah. I think Haas is just like mine. Total Hail Mary on a guy that's done it before, coming off an injury at the back end of the season. Quite a bit to play for. So I wouldn't do it myself. But if you're desperate and you just want to make a ridiculous move, or you're a Broncos fan and you love Payne Haas, do it. But a rational thinker wouldn't. So I don't know how rationally I've been playing this year, so maybe I should do it. But, yeah, I wouldn't do it myself.
Be a mad dog move. I'll shout out to the Storm players have been rested, a bunch of those guys. So Munster's playing, but Jerome Hughes is out, Harry Grant's out. Bunch of the forwards are out, like Katoa, Bloor, you know, Loiero. All these guys are not playing this week. So Jerome Hughes, I wouldn't sell Hughes. I've seen a few people send me their teams, and they've sort of asked, you know, should I sell players A, B, C, D, and if they're only missing this week and they're playing next week and you have a full 17 already, don't sell them. You got that one trade left. You've got 17 players this week. You might as well hang on and just see what happens and then use that trade next week when you need it. Matty
Burton.
Yeah,
I suspect next week, just on Hughes, it might be Munster who gets the rest next week. Hughes might play. So in that case, Hughes will become a stud for the last week of the year. Could be a captaincy option next week.
Yeah, agree with that completely. Now, I'm going to take a victory lap here. So, Matty Burton versus DCE has been the big question. And I reckon I've talked about 300 people out of DCE and into Matt Burton. So
I was the 301st that went DCE. So, thanks for that.
Oh, sorry, mate. Well, if you had a watch.
Okay, last 3 weeks, he hasn't been that bad, DCE, to be honest. Last week was bad, but the weeks before, I was pretty good.
He's scoring all right, but the stat trend is concerning in terms of the base, right? And we saw the ugly side of that where there weren't those big attacking plays last week. So I'm not saying, by the way, like when I was talking about him, I was saying he can score 100 points. So he's worth a shot. It's just that downside is quite a bit lower, whereas Matty Burton's got that safer base. So For Matty Burton again, Manly, this game, you thought it'd be a bit more of a grinder. I can see him going well. I'd probably forecast him for about a 55-point game. He's not a captain option for me this week. And unless you need a half, I'm not really targeting him as a top buy this round. But let me know what you think.
I agree with that analysis. I think he'll be a safe option this week. He's just got the base stats. Dogs are playing pretty well. I think even in a grind, he can, like, Turbo in a grind won't score that well, but I think Burton in a grind can still, you know, yonk out some base stats to get a 50-55. But I agree. Great peak. You know, if you got him a couple of weeks ago, I wouldn't get him in as a half this week, and I wouldn't be captaining him.
Yep, 100%. We'll keep rolling through. So, Huddy Young, I'll touch on him quickly. Roosters is not a super easy matchup at all. He's been pumping it, though, so some big scores. I think it's three of his last six over 70, and he's got the 60 as well. So I'm a fan. I'm a fan of him, but again, right, like, he can score a bit lower as well. So if you need an edge back rower, I like him quite a bit. I like Gussie Crichton a little bit better. But at the same time, Gus does have some injury issues that he's sort of carrying right now and could get a rest depending on how the Roosters are going heading into next week. So Hudson Young is probably a pretty safe option.
Yeah, I looked into second rowers last week because with Madison down, I don't really have a backup, and with only Fifita and Colin Matangi in my edge. And between Hudson Young, Crichton, Preston, it was all a bit of a lottery. I was going to go Angus, but then I'm like, you know, Angus has not been scoring that well recently, could get rested. So I just ended up screwing the depth and getting Carrigan, which worked out pretty well. But I feel like Hudson Young is the one I'd get as an edge player. As maybe not as a captaincy option, but if you look at the other options, like Preston with Salmon back might not get 80, didn't get like huge minutes last week. Crichton, like we already talked about. Nikora is on and off. So Nikora and Hudson Young are kind of similar to me. Like, they can pop off for a big score, but they've also got a mid-30s in them. But I agree with your analysis here that it's probably more of a Hail Mary as well. I wouldn't be my first option for captaincy.
Yeah, the good news for a guy like Preston is Kurt Mann's out for 4 weeks. So with Mann out for that period of time, it means that Salmon goes back to lock. And that probably means that the minutes are going to be better for Preston. And Salmon probably won't play too many edge minutes.
Remember when everyone had Salmon at the start of the year? What a throwback. Oh, I just remembered that.
I hate it.
He was like an everyone's squad base prize stool position. It was pretty good.
He was got 25 points in 20 minutes, and he just stopped scoring.
Like, yeah, or he'd get moved to center every time he'd look like he'd put a score up. What a throwback, honestly. I can't wait for the end of year awards this year. A lot of things to look back on fondly, or not too fondly for me as well.
We will have the voting, by the way, in the link as well, so get your votes in. I think we've had sort of 400 or 500 votes so far, something like that. So heaps of votes in. Get them in. Vote for your favorite players. Dill Edwards, so he's someone that was a popular captain last week, Biz, and you might have missed it, but people were talking about him a lot. He had a good matchup last week. He did nothing with it, and they got beat up by Canberra, down in Canberra. So I look at him again. I bought Edwards last week. I've got a bit of a knack for buying guys who have never scored below 40, and then they break that record the first week I have him. So for Dylan Edwards, I think he bounces back. I think South Sydney is a great matchup. I think no Cam Murray makes it an even better matchup. And I just look at Dylan Edwards and I think he's probably going to be one of the top scorers this round. But at the same time, that form is not encouraging with that 31.
I actually think, these kind of players rarely go bad score. It's pretty rare. Mm-hmm. So just statistically alone, I'd be happy to put the captaincy option on him. Great matchup. Ooh. It's outside that form spike. Towards the mid late rounds, but are kind of falling back to earth again, unfortunately, for South's fans. So I don't mind it. I think they'll have a bounce back game here. I wouldn't be surprised that Edwards goes, you know, big. He'll be looking to, you know, we saw what he did when Clear was out at the start of the year. So I think this is one that's less of a Hail Mary. And if I had Dylan Edwards and, you know, I didn't have a guy like Yo, I think Edwards would be in my tier one category for a captaincy option. And it's an exciting one too. Always like happening fullbacks, because it's, you know, kind of heart and mouth stuff.
Yeah, he's a good shout. I'm considering it just as a fun one. But on the other side, actually, I'm going to slide past a few players because I want to talk about big bad Kalen Ponga. What's he even priced at? Here he is. and we'll just bounce around a bit now, but Ponga versus the Titans this week. I like that. And watching the game last week, he was on sort of 15 points at halftime, and he went nuclear in the second half and scored 60-odd points. So I look at that and just go, oh, has he woken up? You know, the Knights are obviously pushing for that last final spot as well. The Titans have been leaking a bunch of points. This is a pod captain that could totally blow up in your face, but it could also be one of the biggest wins of the year.
I really like it, but unfortunately, the thing with Ponga this year, his good games end up in 70 or 75. Yoan Carrigan will have just like a slightly above average game and get the same. But Ponga, you know, he just hasn't shown that this year he's the guy who's got 100 in the bag. I just don't think Knights are dominant or exciting or scary enough with the ball in hand. So if you don't have Yoel Carrigan, I put him in the same category as Dylan Edwards, where it has a bit of upside, but it's harder for him to get a set. Like, for example, he'd have to score a try, 12 tackle busts to match Carrigan making 55 tackles. So, actually the question for me is like, well, I didn't really analyze Ponga too much recently, but he's going to kind of be priced at the 50 average just like last year. And is he tempting for a buy next year? That's what I've been thinking. But like, if you've already got Ponga this year, I don't mind it. It's kind of exciting. Gold Coast, just like the Souths, had a bit of a form spike and a back down to earth. But yeah, have you got him, Longy? I think you do, right?
Yeah, I've got the Pong, man. I've got the Pong.
If you've got Edwards and Ponga, who are you picking out of those two? I'm just keeping my screen dry. Ignore the Scottish rain.
I love it, mate. You're dedicated in the rain. So with Ponga, the thing that I like here is Bradman Best comes back this week. And I love the shape on the left edge when they have Bradman Best charge you onto that ball. Because anytime he's in the picture, he draws the attention of about 1.5 players. And Ponga is one of those guys where if he's getting even a one-on-one, he is so dangerous. So I could just see that edge absolutely feasting against the Titans. And like you look at the Titans as well. Who's on the right for the Titans? I think it's Phil Sami and Jojo Fifita, I'm pretty sure. So I look at that pairing and I think, oh, can they handle this? You know, both of them are on the inside. Can they handle this sort of raid, play after play? I don't think so.
No, I don't think so. But to be honest, when it's Best and Ponga, there's not many sides that can handle it, right? So even if the good defenders struggle, like obviously there's better matchups and worse matchups, but Ponga into Best is just a lethal combination. So, yeah, I do think he's better with Best. So it sounds like you have him over Dylan Edwards this week.
I mean, Dylan Edwards is so safe, right? So that was his first score below 40 points last week. If Edwards had scored 50 last week, I would be thinking Edwards is the guy. But that 31 has kind of shattered my belief a little bit. Same as when I bought Keeney in. He went and got, you know, 27 points the week I bought him as well. So they just seem to, I don't know, I'm going to choose on Thursday. So my model is I'll do, you know, fantasy advice on Tuesday. I'll do pick my team and everyone else's advice on Wednesday. And then I do my own team on Thursday. And it's always
gut. Yeah, when you've had 50 iterations of telling other people what to do and you're like, oh, you know what? I'm going to do none of that and do something else completely. And Captain Keeney, surely you're Captain Keeney this week.
I mean, let's talk about Keeney because, again, it's the same matchup, right? So he's got, he's right there actually. So Keeney versus Newcastle.
Newcastle Knights have been, are not that much better. Like they're slightly better, but yeah. I'd happily captain a wing fullback against them.
Yeah, I don't know. I loved the game last week. It was a 2 p.m. game. He's been dominant in those games. This one's at Newcastle. I think it's a Saturday game from memory, but I don't know if I could do it. Like one of these options is very exciting because obviously Isaiah Yeo is the option. But then if I don't go Yeo, it's going to be one of these guys. I also have Tedesco. So I've gone super wing fullback heavy.
You got some exciting wing fullbacks, yeah. No, I like that. That's good.
I decided to have some fun right at the end, right? Sort of looked at it and went, you know what? Let's have a crack. But Keeney's another option. He can pop off. It's a tipping thing though, right? Do you think Newcastle or the Titans are going to win this game? I will throw in that Newcastle are missing some guys. So Frizzell's out and Kaipias Paul's out too. So that could mean that the edges, you know, Brody Jones comes in, Dylan Lucas moves into the back row. Not astute defensive back rowers, probably could leak a few more points. You then have, you know, different halves combos as well. So Cogger's come in next to Phoenix Crossland. Again, it could be anything. You know, Braden Best comes back in. He's a good defender. But, yeah, I don't know. Keeney could be an option too. You could look at him. I'll throw some other guys in here too, because actually I've had a lot of questions about Drinkwater.
Yeah, Drinkwater versus... I was going to say the next two on my list in a similar vein would be Drinkwater against Melbourne C team or Lomax against Parramatta also C team, which is the main team. Both of those wing fullbacks are great options, I think, this week as well.
Do you like the drink? Because I'll talk through the drink. I'm getting asked a lot about Drinkwater.
I don't mind it. I think this is the week where you could have one of those big scores.
You're in a true hurricane right now.
But look, after we get through these captaincy options, I want to leave buy, hold, sell to you because this is getting tough out here.
To be honest, this is kind of the buy, hold, sell as well because these are the guys you'd target anyway. So Drinkwater, I'll just talk about him. It's a good matchup. Obviously, the Storm are under strength. I think the Storm will still turn up and play good footy. I think the Cowboys will win the game pretty well. But Drinkwater as a player doesn't have that big bang upside. So you were talking about it with Ponga before, but Drinkwater is, and there goes Busy, he'll probably pop back in a sec. Drinkwater is one of those guys where he has been scoring between sort of 40 and 55 points most weeks. It feels like he's having a really quiet game. He'll be on 20 points. He'll bounce up to 40, 45, 50. And if he's having a big game, he's on 40 points at halftime. He slows down, ends up on 50 at full-time. So with Drinkwater, I'm not the biggest fan of him as a captain option, but I will say on paper it's great. And if you do like him enough, go ahead and do it. I just don't think he has that 100-plus potential that I'm sort of looking for out of one of these types of captains. And then we'll talk about Zachy Lomax as well, because Lomax, Biz mentioned that he's up against Parramatta this week. So, and we got no Biz. I think Biz has been wiped out by the Storm, guys. We'll see if he comes back. If not, I'll just keep on rolling with Yiz. In fact, there is the Bizmeister. He's on the move. Welcome back,
guys. I don't know what happened. I got kicked out. But anyway, my internet died. You can kick me out. If this is too problematic, I'm happy to drop off.
Honestly, at this stage of the year, we only have the true diehards, you know, our favorite people on here. So I reckon it's fine. Like, guys, if you're happy to see Biz, let us know in the comments that you're happy to see him. I think it's been fine.
Is this a year in review? Am I getting reviewed? Is the comment saying whether Biz should come back next year or not? I don't know. I don't know if I want the results to that. Yeah.
We need the contrast. Yeah.
I want a promotion, so please be nice to me.
Promotion. But you're already our international correspondent. You're doing pretty well. But look, Zachy Lomax, we'll talk about him. So I think we're going to say the same thing here. Parramatta don't defend the wings, the edges, the middles, or any other part of the field. But the wings especially, Parramatta don't defend. So I look at Zach Lomax here. I look at a guy who's been scoring between 40 and 65 points every week for the last sort of month of footy. He's coming off a great Origin campaign. He's coming to Parramatta next year, so he'll want to put on a performance. He's playing at Parramatta for the first time since signing that deal. So I reckon Zach Lomax comes out and feasts in this game. I think he could score a double and crank out, you know, 60, 70 points pretty easily.
I mean, he's already scored 100 this year. So we forget that. But like, I'm not saying he'll score 100, but he does have the upside. He's shown that he can put on a massive score. So he could score a double or triple. We say this every week against every team that plays Parra, but I like Lomax this week.
The big question with Lomax, though, is you're not sort of questioning his talent. You're questioning whether Tyrell Sloan can create a few tries for him. You know, whether I don't know who his center is right now. Is it Finoi? I think it's Finoi on the inside of him. But if Finoi,
I think just on Sloan, I wouldn't be surprised if Lomax plays some time at the back as well. I just think Sloan's been a bit shaky to end the year, so good result in 2 minutes at the back. I'm getting blizzarded right now, so I'll go on muting.
Yeah, you're getting wiped out right now, so we'll wait for that to subside. But yeah, no, he could slide into fullback a bit as well, potentially. We'll see what happens there. But Lomax is a good shout. The other thing is dual position. So when we're talking about him as a buy option, you've got that dual for center and wing fullback, which is super valuable right now with how the season is finishing. I'm going to jump back, actually, because while we're talking about these guys, Campbell's another shout. Look, Campbell's been out of form recently. My line on Campbell is pretty consistent. So when he was going super well, I sort of thought, nah, he's going to return to the norm a bit. He's been going poorly recently. I'm going to say the same thing. He's going to return to the norm. He's one of those guys who's going to float around that sort of 50 average, I would expect. And he's been about 10 points better than that so far. But I think he'll slide back to that 50 points. Newcastle is a game where he can pop off, though. So, again, Campbell's one of those guys who can come out and score 70 for you. He could also have a 35-point game. So, keep that in mind. But if you've got Campbell and you really think the Titans are going to tear the Knights apart, that's not a bad captain. And finally, Iroh. And this is weird to say, but if you want a sort of different captain option, it's pretty out there. Right, because I can see you want to talk that you're in the Hurricane.
I don't know about this one, but he is in good form. Hines might come back. They've got an okay matchup. I personally don't know why you'd do it, but you're up for a bit of fun in the last two rounds. Why not?
Yeah, see, I reckon he's killing it. Like lately, he's absolutely dominating. If you're in a Super Coach league, that's where he's a bit more interesting. So I've got him in a Supercoach draft where I play him at fullback because I drafted Will Kennedy, who does nothing for Supercoach. But he's been pumping out massive scores over there. So I look at him as an option where I might make him my captain and drop the VC on someone a bit more tricky like Valentine Holmes or something like that in my team. But Iroh's been on fire. I'll probably point out Max King as a guy not to buy this week. So a few people have asked about him. I don't think he returns back to the regular form. You got Curran on the bench there as well. He could easily bounce back to a 50 average, but the upside isn't worth the risk with him. Ben Hunt's one that's been asked about a bit too. Look, 32 points last week isn't ideal, but at the same time, he's got Parramatta, and Para play like a team who haven't heard of the show and go before. So Ben Hunt will probably try that a few times, and it could work.
If he's running and shining and going into Sean Lane and come on, he'll be in for a good day.
Hey, Lane's at the top. It's Cardi.
Oh, I was just throwing random names at my forward pack. It could be any of them.
Oh, right. I think you meant the edges. Yeah. But yeah.
Could be edges, middles, whatever. Like, so on go. Like, you could do it in the middle of the field to Brendan Ahns. He'll fall for it too.
Hey, we're not doing well right now. Look, we're going to be super biased next year, by the way, guys. So we're getting all these jabs in now so that next year when we're saying Para are going to win the comp in the preseason, it is balanced analysis.
I'm starting with Iongi as my fullback next year. I already know.
Oh, mate, 100%. He's that guy. He's the GOAT.
I don't care if he's named in reserves. He's in my team.
Well, he's got a good name. He's almost Longy. So we have to
I think people were calling him Longy, not realizing the L was actually right. A lot of people call him Isaiah Longy, and I was like, I don't think that's right.
I wish it was that. If he was Longy, that would be the best thing ever. Like,
good free promotional material for this show.
Well, maybe I'd be infringing on trademark, though, by taking his name. That's the problem. Corey Jensen, I just want to point this out as one not to target. So Payne Haas likely back this week. Corey Jensen's been great recently, but if Haas is back, he's going to degrade back to sort of a 40 average. And then last couple of captain options. Is there anyone else you want to shout out here? You know, McInnes, Gagai, Cora. Oh, here we go. Kalamatangi. I know you've got him. You rate this one?
Yeah, he's a solid pick. But, you know, back in the middle, I think he's shown he can be a 65 guy. I think he's firmly, maybe just a bit below the Carrigan-Yo category. I put him in the category with kind of Edwards and Ponga. Maybe less risk. Less upside, but less downside as well.
See, I look at him, and without Cam Murray, I've got him above Carrigan this week. So I look at Carrigan.
Against Penrith, that's interesting. I just don't know if there's going to be attacking stats against them. I mean, he's going to be running at Yo, so it's a great matchup there.
Yeah, I mean, the thing I'm thinking about here is, look, Payne Haas potentially back. Carrigan drops back to a sort of 50 to 55 average, maybe 55 we'll call it. So Kalamatangi, there's no guarantee he plays 80 minutes, but without Cam Murray, he was playing 80. He's pumping out like 300 meters a game as well. And Penrith haven't been, you know, a juggernaut necessarily. Like they've leaked some points. They lost to Canberra last week. They have no Nathan Cleary right now. There's a lot of reasons why Kalamatangi could tear up in this game.
Yeah, I don't disagree. I agree with Haas plays. I think he'll be Carrigan tier, maybe just a bit above. Because Carrigan without Haas is an absolute weapon. With Haas, he's still great, but not the same tier. But I'll probably put him below Yo slightly. But I do agree. Just thinking back to his stats when he was playing lock, yeah, 250, 300 metres, tackle breaks, has got 100 this year, can score tries.
Yeah, no, mate, he can be unstoppable. You're getting a bit of storm noise there too, man. But I'll just talk to a couple more here. So Fifita, another one. Again, he's been thrown around. I'm not a fan of this at all. At all. I just don't like the signs recently. There's been a lot of shifts where he's had the ball and he's looked up and he's had a great one-on-one matchup and he shoveled the pass on. And I'm not saying it's bad for real footy. It's often led to tries. So it's not a bad thing for real footy. But in fantasy terms, he used to look up and see those and run the ball and score himself. So I'm looking at Fifita and I just don't think he's the same guy for fantasy as he was before. And that 60.3, I get that he does average that, but that feels high to me. Like, I watch him every week. I look at my team. He feels like a lower score than that.
I feel like he was just this year has been living off a consistent 55 to 65.
Yeah.
And I think you'll probably think, I quote me if I'm wrong, but I feel like his last few weeks have been pretty average. I think that's probably why it feels like he's less than 60. I think he was a pretty consistent 62 guy, 65 guy when he came back into the squad this year. I think he's in the downtrend towards the last couple of weeks. I would stay away from him as a captain.
Yeah, he got subbed out last week as well, so it's also a point in the downside.
One of the guys, actually, one specky actually is Jacob Little. I saw you scrolled past him. He's been in really good form, and another candidate for Sakara. So he, I think he's looking for a bit of a big score this week. And if you need a hooker, he's probably the number one hooker right now. With Cook kind of losing minutes from Amazelis,
he actually is, right, because then you go Connor Watson, for example. He's on the bench. We'll talk about Watson in a sec too, but yeah, Little's a good shout. I've actually got Little in a couple of draft leagues where I decided just not to pick a hooker and took Little as like the 10th, 11th, 12th hooker off the board. He's been absolutely fantastic this year. Like, he's absolutely killed it. He doesn't play Origin. It's been a bigger year than it usually is for him, but yeah,
he could pop up. I honestly think he could be my gun hooker for next year. Ooh. I think he's on the way up. I think he's earned the 80-minute role now. Versus where, like, kind of being
because obviously Cook goes there. So what club would you, like, want him to be at?
But, like, that's the thing. Like, I know they recruited Cook, but it's kind of strange to me because Little, I felt, was on the way up and he's finally cemented himself as an 80-minute hooker. So I don't really know how that works. I feel like obviously it's way too early to tell, but if the situation was in a place where he was an 80-minute hooker, I'd go him. Obviously, if he stays at Dragons behind Cook, no. But I honestly think there's a lot of places that could do with someone like Little. Para, for example, could do with like a Little. So, anyway, for another video, but that's my thoughts on him.
Mate, 100%. If he came to Parramatta, he'd probably get an 80-minute role and he'd absolutely crush it. So, yeah, I'd love if we went up to Little. Only 27 years old as well. So definitely not old. He's obviously a pace-based hooker, but I think he's a guy whose game's going to age pretty well. So, yeah, Little's a good shout. There's a couple other guys I want to talk about here too. So we'll just roll down to the cheaper end. Fogarty is one who got some kick meters back this week. So if you need a player around that price point, yeah, 650-odd K, you got a trade out that works for it. You can do worse than Fogarty. So Weeks doesn't steal too many of the kick meters. I think it was about 150 kick meters Weeks took last week. So if you want a guy, Fogarty, you know, 54 points, very little attacking stats in that game. If you think they can fight against the Roosters, then he's not the worst shout.
Yeah, I don't have much more to add other than the fact that his average is kind of leaning back towards the low 50s, which makes him exciting to start with next year, just like he was at the start of this year.
Mate, imagine that. He goes back to normal. Then down the list, I mean, is there anyone else that we want to mention here? So Horsburgh is doing a good job of reducing his average. So he'll be a good option for next year at this stage.
Yeah, I heard Tigers are after him, so it could be an interesting one.
I don't know why Parra aren't after him. Val Holmes, if you got him, I actually don't hate him as a captain this week. So the Storm putting up some pretty average edges in terms of experience. And Val Holmes is a guy who often the tries kind of center around him. So this could easily be a game where he pops off for 2-3 tries.
Yeah, I mean, we hyped up Holmes like 4 or 5 weeks ago. It's turned out pretty well. I think he's in for a big game this week too.
He's killing it. He's killing it. And I want to throw a question at you here, man, because you got Terrell May and Connor Watson sitting in the second half. Now, Connor Watson sitting on the bench there, there's a few different options of how this could play out. So it could be really bad in terms of he comes off the bench, comes into the game 20 minutes in, and then subs off again. Or it could be really good in that maybe he comes on 20 minutes in, plays 60 minutes, but plays that last 60 minutes. So what do you think is going to happen here? Good news, bad news, whatever.
As a Watson owner, I'm actually hoping he's a late entry to the starting team. But I feel like he'll play 50, 55 minutes in the lock position, middle forward rotation. I don't know exactly, you know, maybe he'll come on after 15, 20, and then maybe miss a few minutes at the back end. But I think, you know, if he doesn't start, he'll play about 55, 50 minutes, good for a 50 score. And, you know, you mentioned Terrell May. He's kind of, Terrell May is such an interesting thing. Like, he just has huge spikes and he drops off. Like, or he's another throwback from the start of the season. It feels like a lifetime ago. I feel like if Roosters trying to rest their starting props or kind of share their minutes around towards the back end, Terrell could really benefit from that.
You've also got JWH on suspension for 4 weeks. So doesn't always convert for Terrell, but it is good news regardless. A couple of other guys I want to touch on here too. And let me know if I scroll past anyone that you were keen to talk about as well. But Adam Reynolds, I actually mentioned him last week as a really good option in that sort of mid 500s area, if you needed someone at that price point. Now, I have Reynolds in practically every draft league I'm in because I either draft him or I picked him up off the waivers because he was out for such a long time. He won me so many games last week with this big score. It was 124 in Supercoach as well. So that's a team where I drafted Nico Hines and I got Reynolds as cover. But he's killed it. I mean, he could easily get hot at the end of the year. He's historically that 50 to 52 point guy. He's at a not that cheap a price now, but it was a very cheap price, still pretty cheap. Do you think he's an option if you were, say, trading out Madison, you had 620K to use?
Yeah, I think so. I think Reynolds has shown that if the Broncos, when the team's doing all right, he can score pretty well. He's coming off an 80-plus score. 620K, look, I think it's a really good price for him, actually. Do I want him in the team over a couple of others? I think it's, again, you know, matchup-based, like versus Dolphins is pretty good. Especially with Walsh out, like, you know, he's going to get more of the kick meters because Walsh does like to kick quite a bit. Walsh doesn't mind kicking from 200 meters a game or so. So I think it's a pretty good option. Like, it's definitely in the, you know, is it a dart throw? Bullseye, probably not, but it's probably in the mix that it could be a really good buy for you.
I'll throw it in too. It's Rogers next to him as well in the halves. So no Ezra Mam. And normally you'd say that's bad news because Ezra doesn't steal many stats. But without Walsh and without Ezra, he's playing a lot more attacking footy, which is actually how he got this 80 points. And also playing against Parramatta was part of that too. So, yeah, I think he's one of those guys where if you're restricted on price, he's a good shout at that price point. Rolling down the list, do we have any belief at all in Olakau'atu at this stage? Like, he's been...
No. Bit average. But he's... Like, again, he's one of those edges, like I said, Hudson Young, Angus, that can pop up for a big score, has a 30 in him as well. Like, it's probably the same category, really. Manly, I would have said they were in really good form until they lost to the Tigers, so I don't know anymore.
Yeah, I mean, he was a big part of a lot of those turbo plays. So, and he's actually been a big part of a lot of line breaks in general. He's getting a lot of line break assists and that pass to a line break assist and all that. But he's not getting those big runs himself. So I'm with you. The way they're playing is more geared towards the outside backs. And last week it was all turbo, but it can be anyone else in that team too. Anyone else that we want to talk about down here? I mean, if you're restricted on money and you need a player around this price point, does anyone take a waiver on Shawnee Johnson at this stage?
No, he's got a buy next week. I feel like it's solely for... a goodwill, like, thanks for your service, Sean. I'll put you in my fantasy team. The one guy actually just a bit below who I looked at last week.
Who are you going to say?
Speaking of eel, Joe Offa. Yeah. He honestly, I was like, oh, not bad. Probably not. And then he popped out of 70, so maybe we were onto something.
Dude, I'm an Offa owner. I get every draft league.
Yeah, I was like, Offa owner. No way you actually bought Offa. Okay, draft that, it makes sense. But he's scoring well. He's getting like 70 minutes of lock. So,
yeah, good option. Only draft leagues, right? But in a lot of those leagues, I had Madison, I had Sorensen, a lot of these guys, Payne Haas. So I needed it. And he's absolutely come in clutch in this role. Like, even last week, he scored sort of 55 points without any attacking stats. He's a beast. Like, we saw him at the Tigers when he played lock and played big minutes. He was a monster like this. So, you know, if he keeps this role, and again, if you're price restricted, right, you don't buy him over the top guns. But if you've got 575K, you know, and you're like, oh, who do I buy for this price? He's sitting there 564K. Do it. Do it without.
Yeah, not everyone has the cash to bring in a Yeo or a Carrigan or Colomatangi at the end of the year. Like, if this is the best you can do on your budget, it's not a bad option. He could still probably average 50 plus on the way home.
He will.
Jermaine Hopgood is supposed to come back for the finals, so let's see. That's what it says on the casualty award. He says he's back for the finals. So.
Oh, I'm sure there'll be a big impact that he makes at the finals. Last couple down here. I mean, there's probably no one really we want to hammer home from. Reid Marnie, you got much belief there? He's obviously, you know, produced a 40, sort of bouncing back to a little bit of form.
He's kind of like, yeah, he had that hot start to the year and mid to the year, but then kind of when everyone bought him in for the Origin schedule, he kind of just dropped off. It's a coincide. I feel like Dogs got better, but, you know, Reid kind of got worse. Fantasy wise, probably maybe less tackles or whatever, but no, I wouldn't be going in to be honest. I'd stay away from him. I'd go Little myself over Reid.
Nah, fair play. And then I'm going to mention two more guys and I'll leave it to you, Biz. The last word, Kai Pierce-Paul, he is out for who knows how long. Massive gash on the leg, he's gone to hospital with that. They had to stitch it up. I would say it's going to be a couple of weeks. Apparently, it was described as like a shark bite. So that doesn't sound good. And then Samuel Afainu, the week after he produced like 15 points for us, he's come out and produced 72. So just want to shout him out and sort of say, I reckon he's had a fantastic season in real life. He's been relentless. He's been in a Tigers side that struggled a bit, but this is a good reward for his great form across the year.
Yeah, he's been kind of up and down fantasy-wise the last few weeks, but you know, a couple of big ups, which is, you know, he got a 60 not too long ago as well. I think he's got a big future. I think he's going to kind of follow the Olakau'atu path where he might have a couple of years to start his career as a 40-45 average guy. But I don't think he's too far off from the average season. So if you're bullish on him and the Tigers, he's one to watch over the next few years.
Yeah, he's a guy I'd target in draft leagues because he's all upside, right? So that 40 average, he's not going to go below that next year. They're going to have Luai coming in. They're going to be a stronger side. So he could be a good shout. I'll just scroll up the list just to see if there's anyone I skim past at the start as well, just in case we miss them. I'll quickly eat humble pie as well. I thought Nakora would struggle with no starting halves at Cronulla, and he just has not at all. So
I'll say that the Sharks backup halves are pretty solid. Like, Trindle's not bad,
yeah.
And Atkinson's proving himself to be real solid as well. So Trindle as a reserve half plus. Yeah, that's true. Atkinson. Yeah, Brayley McInnes, whatever. Yeah.
Yeah, and he came and scored like 70. But yeah, no, you're right. You're right. Atkinson is actually really solid. Atkinson's a guy that a lot of clubs could sign as well.
Yeah, I'm sure the Knights could deal with a guy like Atkinson over.
It'd be costly.
Gamble, Connor.
And then change it again. last shout, anyone else? I mean, Tarpane. Firma, Nakora, Gagai, yeah, nah.
I think we could talk about a lot of these names. I think they're all in the kind of similar category where if you need a kind of big play, you're pretty desperate, they've got a good matchup, chuck it on them. Like, there's not much to lose this time of year. There's like one more week left after this. I'm already, like, my eyes are already on my fantasy NFL draft at the end of this week. I know I've got ours this week as well, so I should prepare for that. But otherwise, yeah, I'm pretty keen for the end of the NRL season, our awards night, and looking forward to our preseason at the start of the new year.
Frothing, mate. Frothing, yeah. Keen for our rookie draft as well. I got the 106 and the 110. You know, I think you got the 107 from memory. But yeah, cool. Awesome, guys. Well, thank you for jumping on. This is us talking about really about captains, but we're also talking about these guys as buy options as well. at this stage of the year, you know, making money, losing money, it doesn't matter that much. So really the only question is, are they going to score big this week? Are they going to score big next week? And that's what we've tried to answer today. Biz, thank you so much for jumping on in Scotland. One last 12, mate. Tell us where you're at. And
I honestly got no idea where I am, but we're at some castle here. Maybe it's Hogwarts. I don't know. The dogs are barking again. I'm off to... actually, the next place I'm off to is, if anyone's watched Harry Potter, you know, the Hogwarts Express, the train area, like the art, you know, under the Hogwarts Express. That's where I'm off to next. It's a two-hour drive from now. So wish me luck in this rain. It is supposed to be summer. And I'll see you all for the awards night and the last week of Fly Hold Cell.
Mate, that is prime. I was trying to find a photo. I've got a photo of me in front of that castle as well in a yellow thermal jacket too. I think it was much colder. But now, beautiful spot. It's in a lot of movies, that castle. I remember they mentioned that. I just have no memory of what it was called. But awesome. Thank you guys for jumping on. Get your votes in. See you there, Biz, at the awards ceremony. Catch everyone. Good luck this week.